Also, on the chat, I am sharing the WhatsApp link. So if you're not part of a WhatsApp group yet and you want to join it, please you can just click on the link that's in the WhatsApp in the chat. Else you can also send me a WhatsApp on 0837908387 to join the group. I'll add you to the group. Okay, so tonight we're gonna look at functions and representation of functions. Last week we looked at a bit of previous work that you guys covered. So tonight we're going into equations, functions, and then next time we look at linear systems. So that is our focus for tonight. And as always, the session is recorded. And I'll share the session, the recording on our WhatsApp group, and I'll also share the presentation on the WhatsApp group, and the both will also be shared on the Western Cape portal in a day or two's time. Okay, so let's get into linear equations. So I think what we are going to do tonight, you will get a lot of this in your assignments and in the exam. So there's always a big focus on functions and equations and all those kind of things. So let's get into it. So first we're going to look at what is a function. Then we're going to look at linear functions, so basically straight line functions. Then a bit of focus on quadratic functions, and then some of the not as usual or functions that we use that much, exponential and log functions, but functions that we do sometimes also ask in your exam. But the biggest focus normally is on linear functions and quadratic functions. Okay, I think the other important thing is you guys won't need to, again, the exam, as in the assignments, is multiple choice. So there will never be a question around drawing a function or anything like that, because that's not possible in how the exam or assignments are set up. But they might give you a drawing of a function and ask you questions around it. Okay, so we'll do a bit of investigation into some of the functions, how to draw some of the functions, to get some of the points that it's needed to look at, just so that we can explore the linear function, quadratic, exponential, and log functions. Okay, so the first thing nearly, and again, when you prep for your exam later on in the year, there's always like one or two theory or definition questions in it. So it's always just important to have some of this with you. So again, exam is open book, your assignments are open book. So what that means is that you are allowed to have your study guide with you. You are allowed to have any notes with you. So any of these presentations, you are allowed to have that with you. So if they might ask a theory question on this topic of functions and equations, one that sometimes does creep in is that they will give you statements and they will ask you which one is correct, which one is incorrect, and they might list you four or five statements and you need to decide. So things that we just need to know is that variables are basically symbols representing a number. So if I have X, that is a variable. Okay, so it takes the place of a number. Formulas is a step more. So a formula is a special type of equation that shows the relationship between different variables. So a formula might be something like mx plus c. Okay, and then a function is where one variable is dependent on another, so that will actually then be y is equal to 5x plus 7. Okay, so the important thing is when it's a variable, it's something on its own. When it is a formula, you basically have something that, and it might be the formula for Fahrenheit or something like that. And when you have a function, there's one variable with another one. So let's give you another example of and I hope I have a slide on this as well. So the formula might just have been 5x plus 7. Okay, so nearly just that part. And then when you add another variable, it becomes a function. Okay, so important nearly is don't learn this out of your head. Again, it is assignments and exam is open book. So this is just a nice slide for you guys to just have at hand if they do ask something on theory or something like that. Okay. So let's go to the next one where we actually look at functions. We need to solve a bit for the functions, and then they bring it a bit further into how to look at the functions by explaining some other things around it as well. So the first thing is that they give us a function. They tell us the total cost in rand of renting a sailboat for n days is given by this function. Calculate the cost in rand to rent the sailboat for one day. Okay, so this is just, they nearly set up the question that you understand that what you're actually working out is the total cost. So that is the total cost that you're working out. The N is the number of days. So if you want to work out the total cost for one day, you will basically work out the total cost for one day. And then you will just replace the N by one. Okay, so if it was total cost, and that is sometimes what they might do as well. And be careful, let's just quickly resize. And just be very careful when you get these questions that they don't say, calculate the cost in Rand to rent the sailboat for 1 week. And then you replace it with one instead of seven. Okay, so just there's sometimes when we also, last week, we did some of the distance and areas and those kind of things. So also be careful when you look at the questions that sometimes they might be one of the length in centimeters and one in millimeters. So just be careful around what, how they phrase the question and what they ask in the end. So for 1 day, this is straightforward. We'll replace the N by one, because that is that N is given in days. So then our final answer would have been the 6,500 plus 4,125. And that would have been then, if we work it out, calculating is giving us 10,625. Okay. If it was set the question for 1 week, then that would have been 4,125 times 7. Okay, so just be very cognizant of what the questions are that they are asking, so that you just make 100% sure. We are busy with study unit 2. So study unit or theme 2 is looking at functions and representation of functions. Okay, so we're busy with that one. And these questions that I have is from previous exam papers and previous assignments. Some when we were still other sessions that you guys could have joined in the older days. So it is more around some of those sessions as well. Okay, so then the next question on that same equation or function is that they say Nick has a certain amount and he wants to take that family on a trip. So now they're asking how many days you will be able to rent the boat. Okay, so now they change it a bit to say, well, he can afford 50,000 rand to spend on that boat trip. There's a fixed cost that is going off of 6,500. And then there is a daily cost that is going off. And we basically want to find out how many days will he be able to afford for the family. Okay, so basically in this one, what we then will do is, as in some other instances, solve for X, we will now solve for N. So the first step is, let's get all the numbers that is not linked to the N to the left-hand side. So we get rid of the 6,500. How we get rid of it is we subtract on both sides with 6,500. So 55,000 minus 6,500 is 48,500. And that will be then equal to 4,125 N. And then to work out N, we will divide on both sides with 4,125. So we get that N is equal to 11.758. And now what they might do in your assignments is now you need to decide what is the number. So remember, all your answers will be multiple choice, so you don't need to write down anything. You will need to be able to work it out on a calculator, or there's no marking with the question. So he can afford 11 days. Here you can't round it off to say 12 days because he doesn't have the money. Okay, so when we round this off, round it off to what he can afford, and that is 11 days. So again, your answer set might be that they tell you 10 days, 11 days, 12 days, 13 days. And it's very easy to make the mistake to round it up to 12 because that's the nearest number, but he only has the 55,000. So if he wanted to be on the boat for 12 days, he needed more. Okay, so again, just be careful around those things when they ask us to give the value. The same in instances where it might be looking at the production of something. So again, if the equation was about chairs and tables and those kind of things, you can't build a 0.758 table. So just again, be careful when you round it off, that instinct tells us that we round it off to the nearest number. But in this instance, because we're working with money and what they can afford 11 days and not 12. Video will be shared afterwards, so don't worry about that. Recording will be shared as well as the whole presentation. And what I have done for you guys as well is in most of the exercises that we will go through tonight, I've typed out also nearly what is needed to do. So we'll go through question roughly, but everything is in here for you as well, just to go over it again. So yeah, so please don't worry. If you miss something, you can ask. The recording will be available. I will share it on the WhatsApp group. So again, if there are students that are not on the WhatsApp group yet, please, there's a link now in the chat. Just click on the link and you will join the WhatsApp group. I'll just later on again give you the number as well if the link is not working. And then I just quickly want to see where is... Okay, so I'll put in the attendance register link at a later stage. Okay, so now we're starting to, and I think this is also important for you guys to see in these questions. Sometimes they combine some of your study units in questions. So in study unit one or theme one, we looked at a bit of calculations on area and those kind of things. Now with topic two, they bringing that back into the discussion. So now they say, okay, a volleyball court has a rectangle shape. In which it has a width of X and it has a length of 2X. Okay, so that is now nearly a repeat of things that we did in the first topic. And then I say, again, okay, you won't need to draw anything, but let's look at the first question. So the area of a court, how would we write that? So remember, area okay, if you can't join the WhatsApp group, send me a WhatsApp to 0837908387. Then I will add you to the group. So no worries, I will definitely add you to the group. Oh, wait. It might be that I'm just quickly gonna put in a new link. So let me quickly, while we're chatting about this, I'll just quickly put in the new link. I think I did change the link, so let me just do that quickly. So while we are chatting, okay, so area is equal to length times breadth or length times width, so depending on again what information we normally look at. So also important when you guys are googling this, please try that link and maybe that will work. So sometimes they use length times breadth and sometimes they use length times width. Okay, so it will basically, if you Google it, that is the two formulas that you will see. If you can't join the WhatsApp group, just send me a WhatsApp and I will add you. I'll find out and see what is the mistake on it. Okay, so area then is X times 2X, because that is what they have given us. So X times 2X gives us 2X to the power of 2. Okay, so that is if they've asked us to give a formula, that is the formula. Okay, so then the next thing that they will normally tell you is all they can tell you what the area is, and you need to work out what X is, or they can ask you other things around it. So what they will most likely do is, like we're now going to do, they give you a bit more of information, and you need to then work out something different. So suppose the court has a width of 12 meters. Okay, so they tell you X is equal to 12. and that the whole area has to be repainted. How much will it cost to repaint the court if the cost of paint and labor is $11.75 per square meter? Okay, so 12 meters, then if that is 12 meters, your length will be 24 meters, but let's use that formula. So we've got the formula as 2x is equal to 12 times or to the power of 2. So 12 to the power of 2 is 144 times 2 is 288 square meters. Okay, so 288 square meters, they tell us that each square meter, it will cost you $11.75. So if each meter is costing you $11.75, 288 of those will just be then 288 times 11.75, and that will give you a total cost of 3,384. Okay, so basically what they did ask us is if that is now a 1x1, that block cost us 11.75 to paint. How much will 12 blocks be? So that must now be 12 blocks and then 24 across. So how much will it cost to paint all of those? And that will cost us then 11.75 times 288, which will give us 3,382. Okay, so they love doing this in your assignments and in your exams. So, and when we do the exam prep, you guys will see. So we will not just look at rectangles, we will look at triangles, we will look at other things as well, so that we can make sure that all possibilities will be covered. Yes, raise your hand.
I'm having a network problem. How did we come out to 12? Where did we get the 12 from?
Okay, so they told us. They told us that width is 12. So then we know x is 12. So that is how. So they need to tell you that. They can't not tell you one of the sides. So they at least need to give you the information of that one or that one. Or they can give you already then the total of the whole area. But they need to give you at least some information to work that out. Okay, so we can't just work it out. We need to have a bit of information on it. Okay, and that is where I got the 12. It was given to us. Okay.
Oh, I was trying to check that was given. I can't see the 12. Maybe as the information which was displayed or previously. All this information, the only thing that I see, it says it has a width of X meters and length of 2X meters. And they request us to draw.
Yes, so that That is for the first component.
I'm sorry, sir. I'm behind.
Okay, now don't worry. Don't worry. So don't worry. The recording, it's also recorded. So yeah, if you have network errors, don't worry too much. I am recording it so that you can, I will share the recording a bit later tonight on the WhatsApp group as well, that you can get the recording as well.
Okay.
Yes, I am allowed to share past papers with you guys. I will share it, so don't worry about that. I will share past papers. And I also have a big pack of other questions that we will work through later. So I will share that with you guys as well. So I'll definitely do that. Because what I have seen and what is happening a lot with QMI and BNU, a lot of the past papers are being used for your assignments or exams. You will also check if there is under, on my UNISA, under additional resources, there's sometimes past papers loaded there as well. And they use some of those questions in assignments and in exams. So already start nearly looking at, oh yes, start looking at that and see if you can download the question sets and things like that. You can also share it with me, some of the downloads, if it doesn't have answers, that we can work that through as well. So please do that. Okay, cool. So
back.
So let's look at the next one. So yeah, again, you have the answers. So again, don't worry too much. The answers is in the slides as well, that you can use that. So when I share, I will share the slides with you guys as well, that you can have that at hand. Okay, so that was just a bit of looking at if they give us information, how to set up the function. Then we go into the specific functions. So we go into linear functions, linear equations, and this is one of those, again, depending on if you Google it and you on a site or on a short YouTube clip, it is sometimes different how they write it out. So I always look at it, when I look at the linear equation, the mathematical one of y is equal to mx plus c. But you will also see in your study guide, they reference it as y is equal to ax plus b. Okay, so I've done both. So if you Google linear functions or characteristics of linear functions, again, just be wary that there are two ways to write it, so that if if you see something, it's not to say it's wrong. It is just the different ways. And again, between BNU, QMI, DSC, they actually use different equations in the different study guides. So just again, know what we are looking at. So important when we have a linear equation, there's certain things that we normally look out for. So the first thing is we look out for this y-intercept. So the y-intercept is where it cuts the y-axis. And that is normally represented by this number that is not linked to x. So in the one instance, it will be the c, and in the other line, we will call it the b. Okay, so that is your y-intercept. It goes through the y-axis. Then there's something that we call a slope. So if you look at this, it runs nearly right upwards. So that is indicating that there is a slope. The slope is this thing that is in front of the x. In certain formulas, they will give it to us. In certain formulas, we will need to be able to work it out. Okay, so if we need to work it out, the important thing is they would then need to give us 2 points. Okay, so they will need to give us this point, and they need to give us the second point, because the way that we can work out the slope is by saying, okay, what is the difference in those points? Okay, so they need to give us the points for us to work out the slope, or they can automatically give us it in the equation by saying the equation is y equals 4x plus c or something like that. Okay, but they must give us enough information that if they don't give a slope to us, that we will be able to work it out. Okay, the way that we work out the slope is basically by saying we've got the difference in y divided by the difference in x. So we've got the one point of y minus the other point of y divided by the one point of x minus the other point of x. Okay, we will do an example of that as well. But first, just want to show you guys how we will do it. But if it's not the example, we will do an example on that. Then sometimes they talk about special cases of linear functions. Okay, so there are nearly two important ones. So when b is zero, so in this instance b or c is zero, all that means is, and let's just bring in a different color. So if that is zero, we have a line that goes through that point in the middle, because that is where y is zero. And we don't know what the slope is. We just know that the y is zero. So then it goes through that origin, basically, because that is where y will be zero. If a is zero, that means your x will be zero. So when that happens, let's just give it another color. So if that happens, and let's say your answer is y is then equal to 5, the line will be a straight line that goes through the point 5. If it was minus 5, it will be a straight line that goes through minus 5. Okay, so that is where your a is 0. So then your a, because it's 0, 0 times x will be 0. So then we basically only have the y number that is possible. Then we can also get a line that is doing this. So let's get, sorry, I want to just get another color for that. So if we have a line that is parallel to the y-axis, and that might be that it goes there through x is equal to 6. So that is how the line x is equal to 6 will look like. So parallel to the y-axis, but it basically goes through an x point. Okay, so that is how a line will look that is parallel to that y-axis. And then lines that are parallel, so this is more this extra one that I added in here. So lines that are parallel, the thing that we can remember about that is that the slopes will be exactly the same. Okay, and why that is important is that they might give you information that says rewrite or give a line that is parallel to this given line that you're getting, but it goes through a different point. Okay, so then you need to know that the parallel lines means that their slopes are the same. Okay, so that part is around page 126 of your study guide. So page 126 up until nearly 140 parallel lines, 150. And let me just quickly see where up until where it goes around page 153. So there on those pages, there's a lot of examples as well and more descriptions around it. But from around page 126 to 153, there they do give a lot of explanation on this that you can practice. And please, if there is a problem in the study guide that you're struggling with, take a peek of it, share it on the group. Again, the only thing we're not allowed to share is the assignments when you need to write them, but previous papers, not a problem. if there's anything in the study guide, not a problem. If there's anything on the slides that you need to get an answer on, not a problem at all. So that is not the issue in asking questions. Okay, so this I basically just added to, and we will do it now as we go through it. There is, again, I have included the answer set, but this is more, I'll quickly show you a few things that is also just nearly to understand this quadrants and the coordinates and where they fit in. So it's more to get that basic understanding. And again, some of this they might add into a type of theoretical question. So the coordinate system is divided into four areas and it is called quadrants, okay? And the reason why quadrants is you can nearly look at it as quarters. So there is four of them. So they divide it into four areas. So four areas, basically four quarters, four quadrants. Okay, so that is why it is divided into the four areas. What you will notice is in quadrant one, your x value is positive and your y value is positive. Quadrant two, now suddenly your x value is negative, but your y value is still positive because it is above zero. So it is in the positive, but here it goes to a negative. In quadrant three, your x is negative, so you can see all your x's are negative, but so are your y's. So all of your y points here also negative. And then quadrant four, we've got the x positive, but your y is still negative. Okay, so that is just again quickly showing how that will work. So then they're not gonna ask you to plot numbers because again that is not possible in the way you are examined, but they might give you a coordinate system with plots on it and say which one is correct or incorrect or which one is just wrong or something like that. So they might work in that way nearly. So again, just important to know the coordinate system, but not a lot of questions might be asked around it. They might do something that again is a combination of questions to say, and that I have seen, and we actually must somewhere, I will just check that we do it somewhere, where they ask the length of a site or something like that you need to move from the one to the other. So that they might ask, they might also do something like this, just with more straighter lines and ask you to work out the area. So that is also something that they can do, but we will again go through a few questions on that. Another thing that they love to ask is to give you a formula, and then they ask you which one is the correct graph. Okay, normally will not just be three, it will be four or five options that you will get. So how I normally look at it is there's a few things how we look at it. So if you look at the characteristics that we went through, I just want to quickly see where was that. Just want to get the right slide. So there's a few things that I would look at first before we really go into analyzing the equation. So the first thing I normally will look at is that y-intercept. So they tell us, if you look at that formula, y is equal to 3 minus x. So we know that that is the slope, but we know that the 3 is your y-intercept. Okay, so then if I look at these equations, y-intercept should be 3. Okay, so that tells me that is not the correct graph. If I look at this, they tell me y is 4, there it is 3, so that is not a correct graph. If I look at this one, awesome, there is y is 3. Okay, so that is at least one thing that then we've got right. Then the second, if there was more equations, the second thing that I will look at is what is the sign in front of the x. Okay, so if it is a positive slope, it will look like that. So positive slope will always be going up to your right-hand corner nearly. And a negative slope will go up to your left-hand corner. Okay, so that is the second thing that I would look at. So the first thing I looked at is your y cutoff. The second thing is I would look at the sign of your x. Okay, so we see, okay, sine negative goes up to the left-hand corner. Sine negative goes up to the left-hand corner. Okay, great. So we know that that is also going into the right direction. And then the last thing we could have done is to say, okay, but let's then look at the slope. The slope is minus 1. And if we needed to work out the slope, how we work it out again is the change in y over the change in x. And so now we have 2 points. And that point is 0 and 3. And this point is 3, 0. Okay, so they don't, if it's on a coordinate platform, they don't need to always give you the points, because there we can see the y is 3 and the x number is 0. And here we can see x is 0, x is 3, and the y is equal to 0. Okay, so change in y, so 3 minus 0. change in x, 0, minus 3. So at the top, we had 3 minus 0 is 3. At the bottom, 0 minus 3 is minus 3. So there we can also see that your slope is minus 1. So then we know at least that slope component is also correct. So it is option 3 if there was now more graphs. But in your exam, if you only get 3 graphs and you already have identified it with the first one, pick that, go on to the next question. You don't need to always make sure that all the things are correct, because I love to work it out by elimination, because that saves you time. And your exam will be timed. I don't know if your assignments are timed, but your exam will definitely be timed. So that is important, nearly, to also get into of finding some shortcuts into some of the questions. And I will definitely guide you guys as we go through some of these. Okay, so again, what they did, what I've added is just some of the things, how certain things was identified, so that we can get to the right graph. So again, you guys, when I share the presentation, you also have it, so that you can just work through it again. Okay, what they can also give you is a question like this. So write down the equation of a straight line. So they now mix that straight line up a bit. And they say that line is passing through this point. And then they say, well, express this equation 2y is equal to 5x plus 7 in that standard form. Okay, so now they basically giving some practical with that theoretical line that we're talking about. So what they say is write down the equation of a straight line that is parallel to this line. Okay, so remember, when lines are parallel, then the two slopes are equal. Okay, so the two slopes are equal. So what we can automatically do is, this is our original equation. Let's write it in this form, so that we can see what the slope is, so that then at least we have our second equation, the slope of that already. So let's rewrite it. So how to get from 2y is we need to divide straight through by 2. So if I do that, I will have y is equal to 5 over 2x. So all that we did is say we divided 5 by 2, and then we divide 7 by 2. Okay, so that is our original line that we just have rewritten so far in the y equal ax plus b format. Okay, so now we need to get the line that is actually parallel to this one. Okay, so the line that is parallel to this one will have the same slope, but we don't know yet what the B is. Okay, so we know that it will have the same slope, but we don't know yet what that number is going to be. Okay, so we don't know what that B is, but they give us a point that we can use. So what we will do is this point, we will insert into the formula. So we know that this point is 0 and minus 3.5. So what we can, and just remember, this is actually the points X and Y. So what we can then do is we can substitute X and Y by this point so that we can work out what is the B. Okay, so X is 0, Y is minus 3.5. X is 0, so 5 over 2 times 0, that will be 0, so that will actually fall away, and that is equal to plus B. So we can then see that B is equal to minus 3.5. So then we can replace it back into our formula. So our formula then is Y is equal to 5 over 2X minus 3.5. Okay, so that again is why it's important to look at that section in your study guide as well about the special kinds of equations and so forth. Okay, so if that was your, let's quickly go back to this one. So if this was your fourth let's crop it. So if that was your fourth equation, let's just I'll explain that quickly now. So just to finish up this, so they give us the line, they tell us something about that line. So here they told us the line is parallel. Because it's parallel, the slopes are the same, and then they will give you a point to replace in that formula to work out that B. So again, I have given you the whole form of how you will also work it out. Okay, so again, I will share that. If I now look at this graph that was sent on, so let's now look at this. So Y cutoff is correct. Okay, so it is 3. The sine of the X. Okay, so the sine of the X, remember there, it's minus. So if it is minus, the graph must lie like this one. So this formula, if it was written or was drawn like this, this would have been Y is equal to, might have been 3 plus X. And actually also not, so what probably would have happened is it would have gone through that one. But let's not worry about that now. But you will see now, because it goes that route, it must be a positive. Okay, so that is where the difference come in. It is already now in that sign of an X where you would have seen, okay, but now suddenly that tells me that it is a positive line and not a negative line. And that is then where the difference would have come in. Okay, so that is the big difference in all these graphs is they would most likely give you a graph like that. Okay, so let's just be, this was because it was only three, this was very easy nearly to identify between the three graphs. So they will most likely have this as a fourth option. They will most likely rather have something like that as another option, so that it also goes through the three points, the three there with the X and the three there, or minus three with the Y. So that will most likely be your options and not these ones, because you can definitely see that is not. And then another might have actually been one that goes through that points. Okay, so that is more likely to be the four options that you will get to then work with. So then again, you can see if I looked at the three as the Y cutoff, it's that one and this one. Here it should have been negative three. So again, by eliminating, we will eliminate some of the options, but it is more likely that these green lines with these two will be your four options and not a random number where it goes through one and maybe a half or something like that. That is not. So thank you that you have added this one. So in this one, where the difference came in is the sign of the X is negative. So if it's negative, it goes nearly up until the left hand. Here you can see this one is going up into the right hand side. So then the sign needed to be positive. Okay. Okay, then again, sometimes they will not ask it in this format, but what they will be able to ask you again is definition. So, and what I liked about this one is things that they might use more in telling you in the question that you need to work out that two lines are parallel. Okay, so when two lines are parallel, they have the same slope. Okay, so that is more why I added this, is to just give you the options that they might give in other questions. Is they, like you guys have seen in the previous question, they don't give you all the information, but then they say, okay, it's the same slope. So that tells me, or they say the lines are parallel, so then you know it is the same slope. a straight line that passes through the origin. Okay, so that is what we've done, that I've showed you guys. So a straight line that goes through the origin is, that is the origin. So those are two straight lines that goes through the origin. So let's look at all these other options that is left. One line has a positive slope. Okay, so there, that one has a positive slope, while the other has a negative slope, both with b equal to zero. Okay, so b is your y cutoff. So here, both that one has a positive slope, that one has a negative slope, so that would have been my answer, but let's just, that is A. Okay, so we've taken that one out of the equation. A line that is parallel to the x-axis. So let's just use a different color. So if this is now my line, a line that is parallel to the x-axis, so it is one that is parallel to that x-axis, so it can be a positive or negative one. So the expression is y is equal to b, where b is the intercept of the y-axis. And that seems like it, but let's just see. There's no constant term b in the equation. Expression is x is equal to c, where c is the intercept of the x-axis. Okay, so that it's not that one. So I would have said the expression is y equal to b, where b is the intercept on that x of y-axis. So it doesn't matter if it's positive or negative. So that would be that statement of B. Two lines that intercept at the origin. Okay, so that is also A. Okay, so that is just, so I actually caught out myself. Okay, so two lines, one line while the other line. So again, interesting. So be careful, like I now easily made a mistake, because a straight line that passes through the origin, but we're only talking about one. So again, be very careful. So that is actually C for that one, because we're only talking about one line ish where, so it's only that one. Okay, so this is also important for you guys, and I normally say that to my stats class as well, is English not my first language. So very easily you read a question and I've even drawn it and it made sense, but they were only asking for one line. And by that one line, I made a mistake. Where in question four, they talk about the two lines. So I thought, yes, okay, great. A straight line that goes through the origin is, that is how it looks. but never thinking of only one line. Okay, so again, be very careful about these questions and how they phrase it, because sometimes there is a simple trick where they want to trick you guys by just making it as a simple mistake as that to make. And again, it is very easy to make the mistake. So just be careful in when you do the assignments, read the question once or twice or three times, just to make sure that you are not, like I now did, actually assuming something that is not there. Okay, so that was all straight lines. So everything in here was around straight lines. So then the one that gets added now is quadratic functions. And if you guys done maths at school, the other name that they call this function is a parabola. So again, you can Google quadratic functions. You will get short clips around quadratic functions and the characteristics of quadratic functions. But then also you can Google parabola and there will be some videos and clips coming around that topic as well. So just if you want to go and look for short clips or YouTube videos on it, there is just you can Google both and something will come up. Then some characteristics that is important around quadratic functions. The first one is the shape of a graph, and what I thought was very nice is one, a previous student that said this. So when look at it nearly as an emoji, that's a happy face. So that means that A is going to be positive. You're positive, happy face, smiley face. When you're sad, it's a sad emoji, when you're feeling negative. So that sign in front of that A, if it is positive, the arms will go up, you're happy. When it's negative, the arms will go down, it's sad. Okay, so that was, I just loved that nearly method of remembering. So you will see here for the A that is positive 2, great, the arms are going up. For the A that is negative 2, the arms are going down. Okay, so a nice way to nearly remember it. Up is a happy face, down is a sad face. So being positive, being negative. Then another thing that they might ask us is the turning point. So basically where that point where the quadratic function will make its turn. So this, all of these graphs is going through origin of 0, but it could have been that on this line, it is going through those points, and we need to work out that turning point. The way that we will work out that turning point is in this formula, we will say whatever is in front of that x, so we will say minus b over 2a. Okay, so that is, if we wanted to work out that x point or that turning point, that is how we will work it out. So that is one of the important formulas for quadratic functions to know. And again, don't go and study it. You can use this page. What I will also provide you guys in the next month is a whole formula page with everything that you guys would need to know for the exam. I will share that with you. What I've also done on that formula page is I have made notes so that when we get to study units where we need to look at some financial calculations as well, it is all on that formula page. So I will share it with you guys. I have made notes on it so that you know exactly what formula goes for what, but I will share that in the next 2 weeks so that you guys maybe can print it or something like that, and then also make your own notes on it, because again, you guys are allowed to have notes. It is open book, so please don't now go and study and remember all of these things. The same with this, how to work out the intercept on the x-axis. So if I now wanted to get those points, we are going to use this formula. But again, I never remember the formula because I know I can find it somewhere. So on the formula page, this will also be. So also what you guys can do is if you have a printed copy of your study guide, I normally put in sticky notes, so, and I will write on it, on my sticky note, I will make a comment to say quadratic functions. But also, if you have a PDF of this and you guys are gonna write on a laptop, then it is possible also to in those, and let me quickly check where is the, if I can get to the study guide that I have, that I can just show you what I would have done. Let's see. Okay. So I think this is how the study guide looks like. So what I would do if I were you guys, and we are now looking at chapter 2. So I would, and let's quickly go to quadratic functions. So page 156. They talk about the quadratic functions. Now we're going into the characteristics. So here they talk about going up and down. So what I would then do is, so here is that formula. So what you guys can do is you can put a comment to it. So we can put a comment to it and say that is the turning point or x axis. So when you now writing exam, again, you can then just say that you want to see your PDF with the comments. then if I just click on that, it goes straight to that point. So also start, if you can, start using some of the comments within your study guides. It just makes it sometimes easier that you don't need to page through a lot of things, because what I've been through this process as well. So what happens when you guys are writing open book, you think, ah, I have time to look in the book, but the time pressures is horrible. So beforehand, make all these notes so that when you are in the exam, it's easy to get to those points that you don't need to struggle, because then time does run out. Okay, so let's look at this graph, and let's just see if we can work out a few things. And here they said we need to read off a graph because we don't get the formula beforehand. So now we can't go and say the turning point is minus b over 2a, because we actually don't know what it is. Okay, so, but we can look at the graph and we can say, okay, the intercepts of the x-axis, oh, there's one, it's minus 5. There's the other one, it's 1. So that we can read off a graph. The y-intercept, there it is, it's 5. That we can read off, and that we can then actually put in this value of c, because that is the y intercept. What is the value of x at the vertex? And that is a terrible name, but that is basically what vertex means, is turning point. Okay, so again, they could have made it simple English and just told us what is the x value at the turning point. If we look at the turning point, the x value is minus 3. What is the maximum value, minimum value of a function? So if you look at this, the turning point will indicate your minimum value as well. So the minimum value will be what is your y value at that turning point, which is minus 4. If the diagram was the other way around, let's say it was something like that, then that would be a maximum. So again, why maximum? Because you can't get any numbers above 8. 8 is the maximum that it will go. The same here, why minimum? So minus 4 is the lowest that the curve goes. So minus 4 is the lowest that it can go. That is why we call it a minimum, because it's the minimum value that we can get. Okay, we can't get a minus 5 because that is not part of that graph. Okay, so that is just also indication of what the minimum means. Then they ask us, formula, is that a positive or negative? And like we said, if it is smiley face upwards, it's positive. If it is like that, it's negative. So that means it is a positive A. Okay, and then the last question on this, and don't worry, I have, so let, I don't know why I've put that in. So I have put in the answers as well for you to go through. So let's quickly see the last one. If a value of a discriminant b squared minus 4ab is greater than 0, less than 0, or equal to 0. Okay, so again, this is in your study guide, but if we look at where this, so we're talking about basically this thing underneath the square root, and they're asking, will that be negative, will it be positive, or will it be equal to 0? Okay, so if you have those 2 points that it goes through two x's, it means that there is values for that, because it is b to the power of 2. It doesn't matter if that is negative or positive, because that, if it is negative, a negative times a negative will give you a positive. So what that means is, if there is those two, and it goes up, your discriminant will be bigger than 0, because you have those two x values. So then it means that will always be positive. If this was here, if it was something like that, we don't have any x cutoffs, then that would have been less than 0. If it was on that graph, touching the x-axis, then it will be equal to 0. Okay, so then that discriminant will actually work out that it is exactly 0. Okay, so that again is the three things that, if it is going through two x values, the discriminant will be more than 0. If it's going through none, then your discriminant will be less than 0. And if it is going through your x-axis, like it's just touching it, it will be equal to 0. Okay, so that is your linear regression line, and then your quadratic equation line. So then the next two things that we will just touch on is exponential, and then I think the log function. Okay, so what I've done with the exponential function is also just to give you a bit of more information around it. So if you look at this exponential function, they tell us that a and b are always constants, and that b will always be bigger than 0. So what that means is, your exponential function will never be able to cross that line. So it will always run along that x-axis, but it will never touch it or never cross it. So that is the most important aspect nearly of this equation. Then what they will normally do is, and you might see it already in your assignments, is they will ask you nearly to work out the function. So they're not, again, going to ask you to draw it. They might give you like these three equations, and they might, or these three drawings, and they might say to you, which one is y equals to 2x? And then again, you need to decide which one it is. Okay, so that is more likely the things that they will ask you. What they also love to do, and that comes in more with the logistic equation, is what they love to do in the logistic equations and functions is to give you nearly something like this to work out. But we will only be able to do this nearly in study unit 5 or 6, I think. Let's just quickly want to go back to, so when we get to differentiation, that is where we will look at this again. Okay, so they introduce it now to you guys as a log function. They give you a bit more information about the log function, but in actual fact, we will much more focus on it when we get to study unit 5 and 6. The big difference between the log function, now again, you can see, never gonna cross this y. So it's running all the way, nearly parallel at a stage to the y function, will never cross it. So that's nearly the two differences between the exponential one. It runs across the x-axis. The log runs against the y-axis. Okay, so that is nearly the most important. And the reason why it is like that is for any function, and you guys can play on it with your calculator. So anything that you will say log minus 3, you will see that the answer is never going to be. So let's look, log of 3. So let's say that was log of 3. So another thing that I want to show you guys on the calculator is, we talk about log. Some of your calculators will have lin as well. My HP got lin, ln on the calculator. So that might be on one of the buttons, but it is exactly the same as if you have log on the button. Okay, so, and then you can play to say, okay, but put in log of 3 and you will get an answer of 1.099. So log of 3 would have given you 1.099. So put in negative 3 and then press the log button, and you will see that you don't get an answer, because it can't go negative. So if I set negative 3 log, it gives me an error message because you can't go into a negative area because it does not exist. The same if we want to look at this function. So let's say 2 to the power of 2. That is a straightforward one. 2 to the power of 2 is 4. But if we set y is 2 to the power of minus 1, then automatically we think, well, it's negative. But if you look at 2 to the power of minus 1 and put it in your calculator, 2 to the power of minus 1, it's actually a half, so it's 0.5. So what that function does, 2 to the power of minus 1, it's actually putting it as 1 over 2. So it's still positive. That's why we don't have any negative values when it comes to exponential, because all that does, if it is even minus 4, all that it does, it is creating a fraction of it. So it's not making your number negative, it is just creating a fraction. Okay, so that's why when we work with exponential functions, we will never have a y that is negative. When we work with logistic functions, we never will have the x that is negative. So that again is just two things that I think is important for you guys, because what they might again give you is just to give you 4 options, and they might say which one is incorrect, and then they might list a few of these and say 2 is equal to log 4. And then they might say, well, in this instance, we can go negative, but minus 2 is equal to log minus something. Okay, so then we know that is automatically the wrong one because it can't go negative. Okay, so they might give questions like that, but what I will also do is for these ones, we will, when we prep for the exam, we will go through previous papers, previous assignments of the first semester. When you have done your assignments, again, then you can share it with me. I'll put it in a PowerPoint that we will work through to get to that as well. Okay, so that is it for tonight on functions. So what I will do is on the WhatsApp group, I will add the guys that have given me now their cell phone numbers. If you can't get onto the link, you can send me a WhatsApp on 08, and let's quickly check here that you guys can still see it. So 08379083 87, or you can click on the link. It's supposed to go to the WhatsApp group, but again, yeah, you can also leave me a message on this chat if you can't get access to the WhatsApp group with your cell phone number, and I will add you to the group. So what will happen is I'll give it an hour tonight